So I'm glad to be here and glad to be sharing information with you guys today. Let me get a pulse on how many of you are students? And how many of you work for game development companies or are game developers currently? You don't. Awesome, perfect. Okay, so it's about a half-half. Awesome. So today, I think, how many of you actually caught the keynote from my coworker, Vineet, this morning at about 1 o'clock? So I've been with Google for 10 years, and I have been with the AdMob business since we bought it about 5 years ago. And over, the 10-year transition, when I first came in, we were only really starting our advertising business online. And I've just have seen a massive growth in all of our products and a massive pivot in all of our products. Where today, we really have catered and have rebuilt many of our products from the ground up to support app developers and app development as well. So with Google, you can build your app, grow your audience, monetize, and understand what your users are doing and engaging them. Today, I'm only going to focus on the monetization piece. Now, if you want to make a living off of games or you want to get into the game business, it is a very lucrative business. I think the latest stat I heard is it's about a $35 billion market worldwide for only mobile games right now. And think about how long mobile games have been around. Not that long, right? The iOS, the iPhone launched 7-8 years ago, and previous to that, we were all on feature phones and not the greatest games, and not we didn't have ways to pay for those games, or didn't even have in-app purchases prior to the iPhone coming out. So as a game developer, your goal is first to make the best game and provide the best user experience possible. I agree, because if you don't have a good product, you're not gonna make money. But after that, I think what happens is, I'm not technical at all, and I'm not a game developer, but I know I work with a lot of you guys. And what I know is sometimes we're so passionate about building our game and, perfecting the product, we kind of forget that everybody needs revenue at the end of the day to be able to continue to do what you love. So today we're going to talk about how you can best maximize revenue for your games so that you can continue to build games and continue to invest in those experiences. How many of you have heard of AdMob? Okay. How many of you have used AdMob or are using AdMob to monetize in one of your games today? Awesome, great. Afterwards, if you guys want to give me feedback on the product, I'll be here, so please feel free to reach out to me. So AdMob is the world's largest mobile ad platform. As I mentioned previously, Google bought AdMob about 4 years ago. And since then, what we've done is really have innovated AdMob, rebuilt it on the Google stack, and have given it all the innovations that our advertising product has had over the past 10 years. So this past year, we actually relaunched AdMob and gave it a completely new UI. We opened up our inventory to buyers on AdWords. So previously, AdMob had hundreds of thousands of buyers, advertisers, looking for app inventory. Today, we have millions of advertisers looking to buy the same ad on apps. Most recently, what we did is also integrate analytics into the AdMob platform. How many of you guys use Google Analytics? And how many of you guys just use any kind of analytics in your app at all? Regardless of what other platform it is. Okay, so that's something that I do want to change by the end of this, because although this talk is really about monetization, you cannot make smart business decisions, you can't maximize and make efficient your revenue streams if you don't have the data to actually segment your users and understand where your users are coming from. So hopefully by the end of this, the one action item that I'd like to have for everybody in this room is to figure out how to get analytics into your apps as soon as possible. Now, AdMob, when we first bought it in 2010, was a monetization and promotion platform. As I've mentioned, with all the integrations and rebuilding it into the Google stack, today you can monetize, which means you can put ads into your app and have advertisers bid for that space. You can promote. So if you're looking to acquire users, you have access to our whole ad network as well. And of course, you can analyze with the integration of Google Analytics. Now, Google Analytics is originally a desktop platform, but what the team did about 2 years ago is they completely rebuilt it from the ground up. So today, if you actually use Google Analytics for desktop and Google Analytics for apps, you'll notice that the metrics are a little bit different, the setup is a little bit different, and that's because we know that app developers are not like site developers, and we do require specific stats for running your app. When I say that AdMob is the world's biggest mobile platform, this is kind of the scale that we're looking at today, is over 650,000 apps use AdMob to monetize in some way. And some of you guys are in this room today. We really work across the board. We work with the really big publishers, and we work with local publishers as well. The one benefit that you have with us is that no matter where your users are, if they're in Indonesia, if they're in Malaysia, if they're in the US, we have presence there. So we're in over 200 countries. Wherever your users are, we'll be able to help you to monetize and to maximize those users. Now, I mentioned earlier that the app space and the mobile game space is very new, right? It's only about 8 years old. We're at the iPhone 8 right now, iPhone 7, iPhone 6? iPhone 6 right now. I'm an Android user. but in the past year alone, AdMob CPMs have grown over 200%. And in the past year, we've paid out $1 billion to publishers that are in our network. So this is pretty massive, right? We are expecting, year after year, we have seen exponential growth, over 100%, and we're expecting that trend to continue as more users come online, especially in this region. Now, when I work with developers here, there's always this idea of, oh, you know, you guys are paying out a lot of money, but we're not getting any of that. Your eCPMs are rising, but it's not rising for us. And it's definitely a myth. And I wanted to show this chart today to show the growth that we're seeing in APAC. So this is a global growth. The whole economy is growing, and APAC is not getting left behind. Indonesia is not getting left behind. And if we look at where your revenue is coming from, and you know, listening to a lot of the keynotes today, globalization has been a big theme. And this is why globalization is so important. Is, yes, Indonesia is a large market. It is the fourth largest country in the world. But right now, 60% of revenue coming to developers in APAC are coming from users outside of APAC. And that's actually bigger with Indonesian developers. For our Indonesian developers, about 75% of their revenue is coming from users outside of Indonesia. So if you are not focusing on the global market, and if you're not building a game with global presence, you are missing out and limiting yourself on the amount of revenue that you can achieve. At AdMob, we really try to make things simple, and we really want to make it easy for you. So with AdMob, we monetize not only Android, iOS, and Windows Phone 8. This year, we created a partnership with Unity and Cocos 2D, who builds their games on those two platforms. Awesome. So if you are with Unity or Cocos 2D, you'll know that in order to integrate the AdMob SDK, it's essentially a couple extra lines, and that's it. Because we know that if we can save you guys time, you guys can build better features, better gameplay, and that's better for users, and that's better for the ecosystem. In addition to that, what we've done this year is we've integrated the AdMob SDK into the Google Play Services SDK. What this means is traditionally, if you're working, you know, with any kind of SDK, if that service provider updates their SDK, you have to go to their site, download it, integrate that into your app, and then relaunch that into the App Store. And every time you do that, you actually lose users along the way because not all users will update your app every month. Sometimes they'll update it every 6 months, sometimes they just won't update it at all. The benefit of this is because AdMob is integrated into the Google Play Games services, this SDK gets updated twice a year, and the AdMob SDK gets updated along with that. So if you are monetizing with AdMob for your Android app, you will never have to make an AdMob SDK upgrade. So again, saving you time. Now, I mentioned previously that we are in 200 countries and we do reach 900 million mobile devices each month. I just met with a game developer in Jakarta yesterday, and they're launching an RPG game. They said, oh, we have really ambitious goals. We want to hit 100 million users when we launch this app. So taking a look at this, and this is just mobile devices. This is not even the span of our network across mobile and desktop. For us, that's very easy to achieve. Wherever your users are, if you're looking at countries, you know, in the US, if you're looking at Taiwan, if you're looking at Japan, we have presence there and we'll be able to help you gain users there. So let's talk about monetization, which is what we're here to learn about. This is pretty basic. Who is unfamiliar with the four methods of monetization? If you're unfamiliar, I can walk through it. If not, we're going to just slide over this. Essentially, as for a game developer, I think we know that, you know, with trends within the past 2 to 3 years, that 96% of all apps downloaded are free apps. So we can pretty much just cross off that paid download, right? Because if you want to hit 100 million users, and you're making people pay for your app, you're actually gating the potential of your app from the start. I have never paid for an app, ever. How many of you guys have never paid for an app? Because, yeah. And I won't. You know why? Because even if you have a really awesome game, I know that somebody's just going to copy it, and I could probably play that free version. So unless you have a very unique offering, a very cult game, or something that's very niche that nobody can copy, because you know somebody is going to copy it as soon as it gets up to the charts. You don't want to make people pay for your app, because they're just gonna wait and they're just going to go with the free version. Freemium, yeah, I kind of put that in with the in-app purchase. So for me, when I'm talking to app developers, really only two business models exist: in-app purchase and advertising. And why I mentioned analytics before is, regardless of if you're using one model, the other model, or a mix of both models, what you really need to do in order to decide what is going to be the best monetization model for you and how am I going to squeeze out the most revenue, is it's really just understanding your audience and knowing what your audience want, what their behavior is like, so you can actually maximize your engagement and maximize your revenue with them. So our vision is very simple. Understand your audience with analytics. That will help you to grow your IAP revenue with Google Play. And will also help you maximize ad revenue very efficiently through the 10 years of technology that we've developed. So let's talk a little bit about understanding your audience. Now, how would you make a decision on whether you should sell price an item at 99 cents or $9.99 without any data? You wouldn't be able to do that. And how would you be able to decide if you should sell, you know, a gardening tool or a sword to a player that's in your game without analytics. You wouldn't be able to do that either. What analytics essentially can help you do is to create the right customer segment, understand where the user is at in your game, and be able to serve them the right message at the right time. And the approach is very simple, right? With in-app purchases and with the audience of your game, what we know is on average, only about 15% of your users will ever make an in-app purchase. And depending on where your users are at, if your users are at, in Southeast Asia, so in a country where mobile payments are not readily available, that number is going to be much less. If they're in, you know, a tier one country, where payments are more accessible, there's more disposable income, then that number may be higher. But if you're only serving in-app purchase ads to your whole audience, what you're doing is you're potentially missing out on monetizing 85 to 95% of your audience. And that's a lot of money that's left on the table. So how would we apply this if you were using in-app purchases? So I'm gonna take another poll. For those of you guys who have games out there, how many of you guys are monetizing with in-app purchase? So just a few. And is your audience global or are you guys mainly in Indonesia?
Global.
And some of the data that I presented earlier in terms of, you know, a lot of revenue coming from users globally, does that match up with what you're seeing within your own businesses? Yeah, of course, please.
For the Apple, I still have a problem that you send when you send us a code that I send my code. Until now, I don't get it.
Okay.
So I just think the
for the payment.
Yes.
Okay, so the question is, so for any of you that are interested in monetizing with AdMob or AdSense or one of Google's publishing products, what you'll know, will come to know, is when you create an account, before we actually send you payment, we want to verify that you are the owner of this particular account. So what happens is we send you this PIN. That PIN arrives, unfortunately, by snail mail. And a lot of times it can get lost. We expect that it usually takes, especially in this region, about 6 to 8 weeks to get to. If it exceeds that time, just write into our customer support, let them know that you haven't received it. There's one of two things that can happen. One is they'll send you another one, but for AdMob, it's more likely that they'll do some other verification with you, and then they'll be able to activate your account.
Okay, but let's say that we
Yes, but if you write into our customer support, so don't do that button. Yeah, write into our customer support through AdMob, support.admob.com, or if you go on AdMob, there'll be a support line. So if you write in through them and explain it to them, we actually have humans answering those emails, as opposed to when you hit that pin button, it's just an automated, like, they just reprint another one robotically and then send it to you. Oh, okay, perfect. Awesome. So let's talk about growing IAP revenue. I think everybody's just excited to hear about growing IAP revenue. how many of you guys have played Game Loss game Asphalt 8? Yeah, it's a good game, right? So when they actually first launched their game, they launched it 99 cents, the paid app, with in-app purchase, and 74% of their revenue came from IAP. 30 days later, they actually relaunched the game for free. And what they saw as a result of that is an increase in revenue and also 24x installs. Now, why is this important? Because as an in-app purchase game, your goal is to always continue to bring in more users so you can find those whales. Because remember, for every 10 users you bring in, only one or two of those guys are ever going to make a purchase. So anybody who is an in-app purchase game developer, they're spending a lot of money on user acquisition, a lot of efforts on marketing to bring in new users. So by reducing this barrier right away, they were able to increase their installs and bring in more of those paying users. So that's one thing to think about. Now, we mentioned previously that you have paying users and you have free loaders as well. That's the ideal universe that you're either one or the other. But the fact is, it's a lot more complicated than that, right? Because if we were able to look at your audience right now, you'd know that 1% of your users are the ones that are basically running your operation. They're paying for your whole operation. These are the guys that, at all costs, you want to keep into your network. You want to keep happy, keep engaged, and keep them spending money. I know game companies in the US that will actually send their 1%ers, their killer whales, tickets to concerts, buy them box office seats at sporting events, and like fly them, you know, to company parties and things like that, because the goal is to keep them happy and to keep them with you, because if they're not spending with you, they're going to be spending with somebody else. And then as we move down to non-paying users, we have the whales, the dolphins, the minnows. So, you know, there are some people who only make one in-app purchase a month, and they may be only spending a dollar a month with you. But that doesn't mean that you should treat them as a freeloader, and you shouldn't treat them as well either. But without analytics, you wouldn't be able to actually differentiate these people and to be able to serve them the right message. Now, Google did a research last year with Parks and Associates, which is a research company, and we found that users in Japan actually like to make in-app purchases that are bundles. So they're willing to pay more for an in-app purchase, but they actually make less in-app purchases per month. So maybe one or two times a month, they'll buy, you know, a couple bundles that are like $10, $20 or whatnot. Versus users in China, they make a lot of in-app purchases, but they like microtransactions. So they're going to do more of the 99-cent stuff. They're not going to want to pay the $10 and $20. And so this is an additional layer of information that analytics can actually answer for you, is, are my users in China? Are my users in Japan? And how do I actually serve different bundles and serve them different apps? Now, according to AppNanny, and this is actually what I've seen from working with developers as well, is, and this makes sense, right, with everything that we're talking about, is the most successful developers are the ones who are combining both in-app purchases and ads. Because while you're able to understand your paying audience and serve them the right price at the right bundle, you are still neglecting half of your audience. So by including ads to your freeloaders and to the people who are only buying so often, you'll be able to increase your overall revenue. Okay, so it's simple. This is what I want you to do. With analytics, you can find your premium users. And serve them in a net purchase ad at the right price. Okay. And for your capital users, for your freeloaders, you can serve them an ad network ad, like one from AdMob. So anyways, I only have 5 minutes left, but the next section of this talks about ad optimization and maximizing your, here's a case study from Game Basics, which is, who is one of our publishers, and they implement both ads and IAP. 75% of their revenue comes from IAP, 25% from ads. But previously, they were only monetizing 10% of their users. Once they integrated ads, they were able to monetize the existing or the remaining 90%. So very quickly, I'm going to talk about maximizing your ad revenue. When I'm working with developers, it's usually, how much, I finally have 100 downloads, how much am I going to make from ads? The answer is very simple. This is the basic calculation. The more users you have, the more engaged they are, the more opportunities you have to show them an ad, the higher your income potential can be. And we make it really easy for you to find users, get new users, keep them engaged, and to monetize them. So here's an example of that. How many of you have more than one game out there, more than one gaming app out there? So only one game, well, you have more than one. So with a feature that's called House Ads within AdMob, what you're able to do is to create an ad in your other apps to let users know that you have a new app that is launching. The idea here is to accelerate, use your current user base to accelerate your download and hopefully increase your ranking within the App Store, which will help you to also gain more organic downloads as well. What we find is because house ads are coming from you, your users are used to your brand, they trust you, and there's a relationship that's established there already. When you use house ads, your conversion rates are off the charts, because users trust you. It's not like they're downloading a new game from a new developer. So this is one of the best ways of accelerating your app launch and gaining users. Now, with AdMob, what we've done over the past few years is really worked on the different types of ad formats that we offer to you. We know that gamers don't want to just slap banners onto the gameplay. We don't recommend that at all. So that's why, in addition to banners, we also have interstitials. Interstitials are meant to be used as commercial breaks. So in between gameplay level, giving your user a break between each battle or each event. And they come in really all kinds of different flavors. We have images, we have video app installs, we have regular app installs. And we also have, what we did this past year, is actually also include TrueView ads into the AdMob network. How many of you guys have seen those ads on YouTube where you can skip them after about 5 seconds? Perfect. So TrueView ads have been extremely profitable on YouTube because advertisers are willing to pay a lot for engaged users. And you don't know if a user is engaged if they're not actually interacting with the ad. So TrueView allows advertisers to only pay when a user has watched up to 10 seconds of their app, of the ad. And we're seeing CPMs anywhere of $10 for TrueView ads. So in addition to the types of ad formats that we offer with AdMob, what we did this year is launch also a string of mediation features. How many of you guys use more than one ad network to monetize your app? Perfect. So you're probably using something that's called mediation. What we've done is integrate real-time buying features into AdMob mediation all for free. So what does that mean? What we've done is we've partnered with other networks, brought them in so it's easy for you to monetize with any network that you choose. We help you to update the ECPMs that you're getting from those networks so that you're always getting the freshest ECPM and they're competing against each other. Another thing that we do is we take all of Google inventory, and for every ad impression that you have, we compete against that ad impression. So if you're getting 50 cents from InMobi, we're going to compete against that. And if we can give you more than 50 cents, we're going to show our ad and we're going to pay you more. And all these features are readily available within a click. And I wish I could show you the UI. But if you are interested in taking a look at this full deck, I believe that we'll be sending this out to the conference organizers and you'll be able to find it on the site later on. I'll be here hanging out in the back of the room, so if you do have additional questions, feel free to just stop me.
Question and answer section, if there's any questions for two questioners. Okay. I would like to ask about the existence of a certain like ad remover software. Does this existence ever hinder the development or progress of this ad mob?
So you saw in my first 10 slides that RECPMs have doubled over the past year, and we've paid out $1 billion to publishers over the past year. That number is continuing to grow. So while some users may, you know, be using ad removers, it's not a hindrance to our network. Hindrance to the ecosystem. I think that most users like you and I, who are not willing to pay for content, we understand that publishers or game developers and content owners need to get paid somehow. So many of us are willing to put up with that.
So currently the ratio of quantity is still the same around, to keep it growing.
Yes, we are growing.
So there will be no further trip in the future.
I'm sorry?
Maybe they, so these trends won't be going far in the future, right?
You know, I don't like to speculate on the future. I do know that the app economy is here to stay. It's only 8 years old. And if we kind of look at internet trends and what's happening on desktop hasn't gone away. And I think there's room for the mobile ecosystem to grow as well. So I wouldn't be too concerned about that. And if you think about this, you know, we're at 1 billion phones, smartphones only globally, 5 billion phones, mobile phones globally right now. So within the next few years, we're going to have 5 billion smartphones in the world, plus everybody who is starting to get online and will be coming online in the next 7 years. That number is just too big to ignore.
Okay, and next.
From my past experience with AdMob, I believe the interstitial is only open for a select few, right?
So the question is, are interstitials only open to certain publishers? That was true about 2 years ago.
Oh.
So what we did over, remember I was talking about all the improvements and all the innovation that we've done for AdMob over the past 2 years. Now interstitials are actually open to anybody. So when you create an AdMob account, you can create two types of ad units. A banner ad and an interstitial ad unit, and that's available to all publishers.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. And this is the end of the question and answer section. Ms. Goya, please remain on the floor. We would like to give you a token of appreciation, and we will take a photo.